My drug of choice was heroin. I became a heroin addict, and it is a very dark existence, very sad and horrible, horrible disease, and something I would not wish on my worst enemy. I feel that I was personally called to the Capuchin order because I was drawn especially to their charism and way of life of living A, in solidarity with the poor, and B, taking care of Christ's poor in many, many different ways and examples. As Capuchins, we are considered active contemplatives. Both are equally as important. Neither one of these aspects of our lives takes away from the other. In fact, they feed each other. So the active part of our life calls us to be out with the people. The power that we get from our contemplative side of life gives us the courage, especially from the Eucharist, to take that out into the world and embrace the poor and the marginalized and the forgotten of our society.
The Capuchin Franciscans are a Roman Catholic order of brothers shaped by the heritage of St. Francis of Assisi. They were founded in 1528. The word Capuchin comes from the Italian Capuccio and refers to the order's hooded habits. Swiss diocesan priests Bonaventure Fry and Francis Haas established the order in America. In the 1850s, the Capuchins came to Milwaukee. This order would become the destination for MJ, who recalls his journey.
Luckily, my dad had built a very fruitful career in the photography industry, and that was a great passion of mine as well as being a photographer. So I entered the workforce working for my dad in his district at a camera company.
And he had managed stores for me, and he had been a salesman in stores for me, but his performance during 2005 and into 2006 had really started to go downhill, really started to suffer.
This is also a time in my life where I started to experiment with drugs and alcohol.
And I remember when MJ, when it was very clear that he was in very big trouble, I just remember being so hopeless and feeling so hopeless and so despondent that I would be on my knees and I would picture him in my hands like he was asleep. And I would lay him at the foot of Our Lady and just beg her to intercede on his behalf.
And I was continuing to generate a lot of income. I was living in my own home. I had my own car, beautiful girlfriend. Things couldn't have been better at this time in my life. But the drug use continued to multiply and get significantly worse.
I told Mary, no one knows the pain of losing a child more than you do. Please go to your son and beg for my child's deliverance. And this was my prayer day after day after day.
Eventually it caught up with me, all the lies, the cheating, the stealing that I was doing to supply my drug habit. It all culminated one day in what I would consider to be the worst day of my life. And my dad pulled me into his office and he sat me down and
closed the door behind him and we had a talk.
He really had no choice. But he looked me in the eye and he said, son, I'm sorry.
Essentially, I ended up firing him.
This was definitely one of the worst days I've ever experienced and a truly depressing feeling. Knowing how absolutely proud you can make your father and at the same time how absolutely disappointed you can make your father at the same time.
And then Michael called me. He was crying. He was broken hearted. but he had to do what he had to do.
This catapulted me down a deep, dark road in a spiral that I began to use more and more drugs and alcohol to cope with this feelings that I had and this depression that I was in, and it eventually landed me on the streets of Portland, Oregon. I was completely homeless, living under bridges and eating out of trash cans, and that was my day-to-day existence, just trying to get the next fix.
Born in 1983 in Sacramento, California, Michael Joseph, or MJ as his friends call him, had a well-protected childhood and started out successfully in his professional life, working for his father. But nothing of his upbringing protected MJ from giving in to the temptation of drug use and ultimately paying the price. He was on a downward path that seemed to have no end.
When I woke up the next morning, I had a brief moment of clarity, and something deep in my soul told me to call your father. And so that's what I did. I hustled up enough change and I called my dad.
I looked at the caller ID and it was from the area code where we had just moved from in Vancouver, Washington. But I didn't recognize the number. So I answered it, "Hello, Dad, this is MJ. Can you get me out of here?"
I had no idea that they had moved. So this is a part in my life that I consider to be a series of miracles, modern day. The first is that the phone number that I called my dad for help was his Portland cell phone number. Now, why I consider this to be a miracle is that I didn't know they had moved across country, and this phone number was only active for 3 more days. So it was pretty amazing that after a couple years of not speaking to him, I finally decided to call with 3 days left on the timer.
MJ's self-destructive lifestyle and heroin addiction broke his parents' hearts. But instead of giving up, they turned to prayer. Prayer for their son's deliverance.
The second miracle that I consider is later on my parents told me the story that the moment that phone rang from me, they were on their knees praying a rosary for my deliverance. This is something I don't consider to be a small coincidence.
And when I meant deliverance, what I was praying for was him to be out of the situation that he was in. Any way our Lord could find a way to do that, I would be grateful. And I knew that there were only 2 ways out of that situation. He was either going to get better or he was going to get dead. And I told God that would be okay. And I can tell you at that moment, I truly would have accepted his death easier than I could have accepted him being cold and hungry and sick and being hurt out on the streets of Portland, addicted to heroin.